So I want to do two things today. One is I want to finish up briefly, I hope, our discussion of compactifying parameter spaces, spaces that parameterize curves in projective space or with maps to projective space. And then I have to say a few words about corresponding compactifications of the moduli space of abstract curves. So that's going to be a little tricky because while there may be some people still in the North American landmass who don't know about the Newton-Lunsford compactification, they probably aren't in this room. But I do have to say a few words about that in case, just to lead into some of the topics we'll talk about later on. Anyway, compactifying the parameter spaces, in some sense, this is the sort of common open subset of all parameter spaces that we're given. Just talking, if n is at least three, we're talking about smooth curves embedded in projective space. If n is two, obviously we can't be that restricted, but we look at basically the space of plane curves with nodes. And for n equals one, we look at simply branching covers. And in each case, this is an open subset that's common to all the standard parameter spaces. And we'd like to compactify them in some way, and for the various reasons that we suggested. So the one remark I wanted to add to what I was saying last time is we have a notion of what a good compactification is. And in particular, a good compactification is one where you you don't have the extraneous components. In other words, to compact, we could always, for example, view this as an open subset of a Hilbert scheme, at least in the case where n is at least three. And the natural, most obvious thing to do is just take the closure in the Hilbert scheme, in other words, include all flat limits. The problem is that the Hilbert scheme itself has many extraneous components. And so we talk about the Hilbert scheme, and I give you a point on the Hilbert scheme. We don't know, and we don't have any really reliable way of telling when that point lies in the closure of this locus. And that creates, as I've said, problems when we try to use the properties of the Hilbert scheme. There's another compactification we discussed, which was the Kassegger space. And that also, as I indicated, has extraneous components, and it also suffers from the problem that we don't know when a given point is in the principal component or not. So I mentioned finally at the end that for n equals 1, in general, and I'll say this many times, the cases n equals 1 and 2 are special in many respects. The case n equals 3, we know very little. Even the space of smooth curves will, in general, be reducible. It will have components of different dimensions, which may or may not coincide with the sort of naive expected dimension. But for n equals 1 and 2, in both those cases, the space that we're describing here is actually irreducible of the expected dimension. Those are well-behaved. And for the case n equals 1, we likewise have a very well-behaved compactification in the space of admissible covers. You can quibble that it's too large. You might prefer something with maybe a touch fewer boundary components. But it's still irreducible. And so any admissible cover is, in fact, a limit of simple branch covers. You don't have to worry about that. N equals 2, this is the point I want to make, we are still looking for a good compactification of this. We might hope that there is one simply because, in other ways, the Severi variety, this space parameterizing plane curve, is so well behaved. But this is still very much an open problem. So let me just write that down, and then we'll move on. Thank you. as we saw in the examples last time, even the conservative space has lots of extraneous components, and again, we don't know how to deal with those. Now, all these parameterize curves with maps to projective space, right, or embedded curves. And so, as I said, there's a natural sort of a priori first thing you would do if you wanted to compactify is you would simply include all the flat curves. Notice they can go into the codes. But again, now let me say a few words about the case of NG, which is the moduli space of abstract curves. This is just a set of C, since the C is smooth in genus G. And just to emphasize the point, this is up to isomorphism. How do we compactify? Well, here we're in a different sort of realm, because we don't have an a priori stable limit. Stable limits exist for subschemes of a fixed scheme or a family of schemes. They don't exist. You can't talk about the stable limit, sorry, the flat limit of a family of abstract curves. So what do we want to do? Well, as I said, we want a modular compactification. So in other words, we want to consider this set of smooth genus G curves. We want to enlarge that set to a larger class of isomorphism classes of curves in such a way that the larger class is again parameterized by the points of a variety, and that variety is projective. Okay. So we want a larger class of curves to compactify. Now, whenever we do this, there's a certain tension. Again, as I said, I'm sure you're familiar with a lot of this, but it's worth saying because we're going to come back to this later on. And this is one of the areas of tremendous and very fruitful work. When we want to enlarge the class, there's a basic tension. You see, what does it mean to say that the parameter space for this larger class of curves is compact? It means, given a family of smooth curves of genus G, over a punctured disk, so this is a family like this, over a punctured disk or punctured spectrum of the DDR, whatever you like. And we have a family of smooth curves. We should, by the evaluative criteria, we should be able to fill this in. We should be able to, you know, we get a map from this punctured disk to the moduli space. And we should be able to extend that map uniquely in this compactification. In other words, there should exist, in some sense, a unique extension to a family of allowed curves over delta, but curves of this class, whatever class of curves we choose. Now this is, again, there's a basic tension here between the existence of an extension and uniqueness. If we throw in too many isomorphism classes, we don't have uniqueness, and the corresponding space, if it exists in any sense, is not separate. And that would be one possibility, is you could just take all isomorphism classes of one-dimensional schemes of arithmetic genus G. That's perfectly well defined. That, in fact, is parameterized by a really horrible stack. But it exists. And you know, you could actually, it's been one or two occasions where it was useful to introduce that object. But it's not a space you want to work with on a regular basis. It's just really, really, really unseparated. So you need to throw in enough additional curves so that there exists a limit in any one parameter family, but not so many that there's more than one. And so let me just say that, of course, the first solution of this was proposed, established by Dedekind and Mumford. And they considered the family of stable curves, which is exactly the set of known curves connected always with finite polynomials. And that was exactly right. The basic idea is that given any family of smooth curves, there's a unique way to fill in, possibly after a base change, to a family of noble curves with finite points.
Yeah. I just meant to work circle. A circle point, I think Meyer and Mumford actually introduced
really?
These curves. Yeah, like in 1963. It's just they didn't do anything with them, with Galena Mumford.
They just introduced the class.
They introduced the class, yeah.
Yeah. Well, you know, in some ways, just to pursue that, it's for a lot of the reasons that we talked about, one of the reasons we want a compactification, in some sense, just exhibiting a class of curves with this fundamental, that satisfies, so to speak, this value of criteria, does a lot for us. You see, I mean, let me be a little bit philosophical here. There is, as I said, two reasons why we want to compactify these spaces. One is, the standard one is, we want to be able to use the methods of modern algebraic geometry, which are heavily based on projective or at least complete varieties schemes. Right? If we want to, you know, calculate most of the numerical invariants that people are interested in, those are all defined in terms of compactification. But the other reason is simply that we'd like to have be able to degenerate curves in a reasonable, controlled way. And the basic idea here is whenever we're looking at a family of curves in projective space, even if our interest is not a priori with a moduli space of abstract curves, if we're dealing with a family of curves in projective space, and it's degenerating, it's becoming highly singular, not reduced, arbitrary, what we're saying here, what Galena, what I guess Meyer and Mumford were saying is, you can always realize the flat limit of that degenerating family of curves in projective space as the image of a stable curve, as the image of a noble curve. So as bad as the curve can get in projective space, you can always try to analyze it by viewing it as the image of a noble curve, no worse than nodes of single variables. So that is really a large part of it. It's just exhibiting a family of curves, or isomorphism classes of curves, that satisfies its value and criteria. So you're saying that was Meyer and Mumford.
Well, Meyer and Mumford introduced them, but the semi-stable reduction was the Galena Mumford.
Oh, wait, so what did Meyer and
Mumford
say?
Meyer and Mumford didn't introduce that class of curves and said, oh, this is a class of curves we should study, but they didn't do anything right there.
I see. Okay, I thought the semi-stable reduction was known before then.
Well, I mean, use the semi-stable reduction approach to the first group.
I see. Okay. All right, so look, I don't want to take up all our time, and I especially don't want to, I mean, I realize this is stuff that you've seen in various contexts, but the main point I want to make, two points really, is that this process of finding a unique extension, this is, I think I've been using this term now for a few sentences, finding this extension is a process called stable reduction. And it's very constructive. In other words, it's not just an abstract existence statement, but it's actually a process whereby you can start with a given family and arrive at a family of stable. And the standard, you know, the pr- two steps. There are basically two steps. If we start with a family of curves that specialize into something that is not global, as singularity is worse than nodes, not to be northern again. More interesting singularities than nodes. The first thing we can do is we can blow up until this special fiber has set theoretically global crossings. So we basically take any extension of this into a family of curves. We can embed it in projective space and just take the flat limit, and that will have God knows what kind of singularities, but it will be a family of curves over the whole disk. And if it has something like, for example, cusp, well, we'll probably blow up until we get special fiber has set theoretic global crossings. And this is, again, since we're talking about surface here, this is a completely mindless process. Just, you know, if you see a singular point, you blow it up. If you see a singular curve, you normalize. And you just keep doing. And this is, in this case, it's pretty straightforward. We blow up once, we get two component curves, the special fiber, where this is the exceptional divisor, and this is the proper transform of the original fiber. Still not normal crossings, even set theoretically, so we blow up again, and now we have this. We have two exceptional divisors and the original fiber. We blow up one more time, and we get now three exceptional divisors and the proper transform of the original curve. This is set theoretic global crossings, finally, but of course it's not scheme theoretic. In the special fiber, meaning the scheme theoretic pre-image of zero in this place, these components appear with multiplicity. The original curve, of course, is reduced because this is a double point. The first exceptional divisor appears with multiplicity 2. The three curves here appear with multiplicity 3, 2, and 1. And finally, you have 6, 1, 2, and 3. Okay? And the second step is we make base changes. And after each base change, we may very well have to normalize to reduce small distance. And making a base change and normalizing essentially amounts to taking a cyclic cover of this. Say, for example, if I was making a base change of order 2, I would maybe make a cyclic cover. If a base change of order 2 and normalizing, it's the same thing as taking a double cover of this surface branched exactly when the components of odd multiplicity in the special file. And since that locus is smooth, again, you have a smooth surface, and that reduces the multiplicities of the components that are divisible by 2. I'm not going to throw all this out. The point is, at the last stage, you make a base change of order 3, and again, that's a cyclic triple cover branched over the union of the components whose multiplicity is not divisible by 3. And what we wind up with is a family with a curve. The triple cover of this curve of multiplicity 6 cyclically branched at these 3 points. And so that's an elliptic curve. And we have the proper transform of the original fiber. And then we have a whole bunch of other components, all of which are rational curves, smooth rational curves of self-intersection minus 1, and can be blown down. So in the end, we just get a very familiar pattern. We get the normalization of the original cuspal curve with an elliptic curve attached at the point line over the cusp. So, again, the point simply is that this process of finding the actual limit or describing the limit is a straightforward one. Now, the reason I'm mentioning this in part is to set up a future talk. One of the, as I said, one of the areas of really beautiful and activity currently has to do with revisiting this solution to the original problem of Von Meyer, Deligne, and Love. Namely, there is always, as I said, this tension between introducing more classes of curves but losing separatedness, or introducing fewer classes of curves and not having it be compact. But it's not like the universe of curves is linearly ordered, and you just have to go up to a certain point and stop. There are many different solutions to this problem. For example, I mean, nodes are, by any account, the simplest singularities of curves curve can have. Right? You have to include those. But the second simplest, I think most people would say, would be cusps. And so why not include cusps as well? Isomorphism classes of cusp curves. And the answer is clear, because here you have a family of curves, in fact, two families of curves, with the same fibers away from the origin, but two different fibers over the origin. And if you're going to allow this as a point in your moduli space, you can't allow this one, or your space won't be separated. So if you're going to include cuspid curves, you have to eliminate curves with elliptic tails. Having said that, can you do it? Can you actually construct a space, a compactification of MG, in which you do allow exactly the cuspid curves, but not the elliptic tails? And this was originally done by a student of mine named Schubert, David Schubert.
Giesecke's.
What?
Student of Giesecke's.
It was a student of Giesecke's, yeah, okay. Of course, it was too late to be a student of Giesecke's, right? He was sworn off on the great job. It's a student of Giesecke's, David Schubert, who, using geometric invariant theory, constructed a space in exactly this way. But then the process got really started in earnest when Sean Keel and Brendan Hassett started looking further and saying, well, let's continue. Let's look at other possible ways in which we could do this. And this was partly an idea of Sean Keel's, because he wanted to know how these different birational models of MG related to the minimal model. That's really just been a beautiful and still, in some sense, philosophically unexplained phenomenon. That when we take the moduli space, of course, they take start with the Deligne-Mumford compactification, and start applying the minimal model. You're going to get different birational models of this space. In fact, what we're seeing here is two different ways of getting birational models of MG. One is to vary the moduli problem, replace this family of stable curves with a different class, still satisfying this fundamental value criteria. And again, if we're including smooth curves, then you get another projective variety that includes MG as an open subset. The other thing you can do is you can apply the minimal model proof to the space MG bar and see what you get. And there's no reason a priori to think that these two classes of birational models of MG have anything to do with one another. Well, I mean, in hindsight, it seems pretty clear, but it's, I mean, we can justify this, but the fact is, when you apply the minimal model program to a moduli space, why would you expect the resulting birational models to be moduli spaces again? And conversely, when you vary the moduli problem to get different birational models, why should those be models that are, you know, that appear in the course of applying the minimal model? A third thing you can do, by the way, again, I didn't mean to get into this, and this is, as I said, a topic of the future lecture. The other thing you can do is if you use a GIT construction, geometric invariant theory construction of the modular space, you can vary the parameters there. Vary the polarization, and there are other things you can do. And again, these can be different bidirectional models. And again, to a really remarkable degree, these overlap with the models that you get from varying the moduli problem and from the applied to minimal model. So that's coming up. I think we have to move on for now. Okay? I had one other question I wanted to raise, which is just, I don't know, it's sort of a fun problem. And it's still not known, and in some ways it's I don't know how central it is, but I think it's worth raising. So one further problem. And then we'll move on. I'm just going to phrase this in a particular way. We are interested in the map from these Hilbert schemes or whatever of curves in the projective space to the moduli space. And we can, I want to just ask a sort of simple question. When are, let me put it this way. We have a map from this locus, however we interpret it, EGN, to MG. There's, question is the image closed? And that's not, let me do an example. I think it's best to think about this in a fairly concrete case. This is the first case that I ran across, which was resolved. Look at plane pointed curves, smooth plane pointed curves. Okay. So space is smooth, plane pointed. This is just, of course, an open subset of P14. It's what we're calling these days H smooth degree 5 genus 6 P2. Right? And it maps to the moduli space of curves of plane Dixon is an open subset of P20. Right? It maps to the moduli space of curves of genus 6. Now, the question is. Is the image closed? The image is a 12-dimensional subarray for this 15-dimensional space. And if not, what is in the closure? Now, if you think about it, a curve, certainly any curve, that is realizable as a smooth plane quintic has a line bundle of degree 5 with three sections. And so by upper semi-continuity, the same is going to be true for any limiting smooth curve. It's going to have a G25. Well, how could that G25 fail to embed the curve as a plane quintic? It can't be birational onto a curve with singularities, because the genus 6 is the maximum possible genus for a plane quintic curve, and in fact, it's exactly the genus of a smooth curve. But the map doesn't, and of course you think, well, if it's a map of degree 5, how could it fail to be birational since 5 is a prime? Well, the answer is there's one thing that could happen. It could acquire a base point. This all the sections of this line bundle of degree 5 could vanish at a common point. If you strip away that point, the resulting linear series would be a G24, and that could very well map you 2-to-1 onto a conic. In other words, the curve could remain smooth in the abstract, but become hyperelliptic. The question is, does that happen? So in other words, if the image here is not closed, then the closure has to consist entirely, or the boundary has to consist entirely entirely of hyperlithic curves. What's not so clear is, are those hyperlithic curves in the abstract actually limits of smooth plane elliptics? And the answer in this case is yes, though it's not at all clear. The first person, I think, to really prove this did it by exhibiting a family of plane quintics specializing to a double conic medial and tangent line, and then arguing that for this particular family, the stable reduction was a smooth hyperelliptic curve. The stable limit was a smooth hyperelliptic curve. It was really messy. Now you can prove this abstractly that the hyperelliptic curves do lie on closure. I'm going to leave that. I'm going to chew up way too much time, but I'll leave it as an exercise to show that the closure of the image in this case contains exactly the locus of hyperelliptic. So that's one case, and it's, as I said, in the order of an exercise, but this is just one case, and even just looking at smooth plane curves of higher degree, the answer is not known what the closure is. So, again, of course, plane curves of higher degree. Some but not all trigonal curves, and we don't know which ones. So even just, and again, this is just to emphasize the point, this is in MG, not MG bar. For plane quintics, we don't know the answer in M6 bar. If I give you a stable curve in genus 6 and ask you, is this a stable limit of plane quintics? Well, I shouldn't say you can't tell me. I couldn't tell you the answer to that. So it's there's a lot of questions about these maps between these spaces that are still, we think we would know that we don't. Okay. So I'm going to erase most of this, and then we're going to start talking about sort of some of the finer invariants of these parameter spaces. So here's a couple of ways of thinking about what we're going to do now. One is, so far we've talked about these parameter spaces, schemes, and so on. We've mainly focused on describing the useful components and their dimensions. In some sense, we're asking about codimension zero subvarieties of these spaces. And now, having said what there is to say about those, I want to move on to codimension one. In other words, I want to look at divisor classes. I mean, more generally, all these spaces, these Hilbert schemes and so on, have in them all sorts of interesting subvarieties. If you're looking at curves in projective space,
right,
or even just with a mapped projective space, there are, you could look at curves that have exceptional inflectionary behavior, you could look at curves that have exceptional secant planes, you could look at curves that have exceptional multi-tangent planes. You know, there's a certain, you would expect a curve in a given projective space to have certain secant planes. You know, like a curve in P3 should have a finite number of four secant lines, but no five secant lines. The locus of curves that do have exceptional secant planes forms a subvariety. There are all these subvarieties in the space of curves that are of interest to us potentially. And we'd like to know what relations there are among them. So in some sense, what we're asking now is for to give some framework, some description of the cohomology with Chowdhury in these spaces. And in those terms, to be able to describe the classes of these naturally occurring subvarieties. Now, the problem is, this is just way too hard. So what I'm going to do, at least in the context of these talks, is focus on the codimension one subvarieties that we talk about in Picard. This is also, you know, by far the most important because it's the divisor classes and water bubbles are exactly what arise when we try to analyze the global geometry of these spaces. Of course, that in turn is maybe just simply a historical artifact because the higher codimension challenge groups are too difficult to work on. In any case, the point is, I want to talk now about Picard groups of these graphic spaces. And I want to include in this discussion, but both the Hilbert schemes and the moduli space NG of abstractors. Now again, there are a lot of subvarieties of these spaces that are interesting. I mentioned some in connection with the curves embedded in the projective space. You can likewise define a lot of subvarieties of the moduli space of abstract curves simply by taking the canonical embedding. I mean, you can look at curves that have special inflectionary behavior, those are curves with special water stress points. You can look at curves that have exceptional secant planes. With regard to the canonical embedding, those are, as we've said, just the real Noether loci. You can look at curves with exceptional multi-tangent planes, and among those are the curves with theta characteristics, vanishing theta planes. So we get these subvarieties, but we'd like a framework in which to try to calculate these particular classes. So suppose we forget about these particular divisors and just ask in general, suppose we have a parameter space for schemes with a mapped projective space, or for that matter, just abstract schemes. How can we generate classes on that space? And there's a sort of canonical answer. So here's what I want to suggest we do. If we have a moduli space, I'm going to do this in terms of curves because we have the notation on the board. But I'm going to make the point that this applies much more broadly. Over the moduli space of curves, we have a universal curve. This is the family or a family whose fiber over a point here is a curve of the isomorphism class referred to right now. And what we can do is we can look at the relative dualizing sheaf of that family. Look at its first chair class. That gives us a class on this total space in this family of curves. If I want to describe classes in the Chow grid of NG, all I have to do is take powers in this class and push them forward. So for example, if I want to, it's going to call this map pi. If I want divisors, I can just take this class, the germ class of the relative dualizing sheaf, square it, and then push it forward. And this is what's called kappa in the Descartes group of energy. Okay. Now, if I have a family of curves, if I take this picture here, and I apologize for this, but I'm going to now replace this by a one of these Hilbert schemes, HDGN. Just for the moment, I'm going to be unspecific about what classification I'm taking here. But I have a family of curves likewise here, but now I also have a map to project a space, Pn, on the total space of this map. And so in addition to the relative cotangent, relative tangent one, whichever, I also have to pull back some classes from Pn. So in this situation, we also have, I'm going to say, let alpha be f upper star of OPn1, just to pull back the hyperplane class. Let omega be the first chair class of the relative dualizing sheaf. And we have classes here, pi over star of alpha squared, pi over star of alpha omega, and pi over star of omega. That's the kappa class. And this is just the kappa class pulled back from the modulus piece, abstract curves. So I'm going to call these classes A, B, and C. Okay? And this is something you can do whenever you're dealing with a parameter space or moduli space of either abstract varieties or schemes or subschemes of a projective space, or for that matter, subschemes of a fixed space. You can just take all the classes that you get by looking at the relative tangent level and all the classes that are pullbacks from the target space, mix them all up, take all the products of the suitable codimension, suitable degree, and push them forward. And the universal conjecture is they generate. Now, this is, I should say right off the bat, this is false. So maybe I shouldn't be calling it a conjecture. But it is. I mean, it's, and that's what it's called, typically, in the situations where it hasn't yet proven to be false. I'm being kind of negative or dismissive, but the fact is there are a lot of situations where we believe these things to be true. And that's what I want to talk about in the remainder of today's lecture. So the general conjecture, is that these classes generate pick of NG and H. I'm just going to use H. There's no need for the subscripts at all. Okay. Moreover, there's a second conjecture. As long as we're conjecturing things that are visibly false, that the classes that we've introduced here, alpha and omega, generate the relative Picard. Pick of the universal curve over M, and again, respectively, the universal curve over M. All right. So, these are two conjectures. They have a bizarre history and a nomenclature is a little bit iffy. Basically, these are sometimes referred to as Frontera conjectures and sometimes as Enriquez conjectures. The name, I think, properly should be Enriquez conjecture. Enriquez first proposed this, these questions in suitable form. For example, the second statement about the relative carbon, he simply phrased it in the following way. He said, the only rationally determined line bundles on a curve. And remember, this is 19th century. So a curve means a plane curve, right? And that says he's worked, his idea of moduli space is working with HDG2, the space of plane curves. And he wants to know how many ways are there of associating to a general curve a line bundle on that curve. And his conjecture and answer, which is still a standing conjecture, is that any such assignment to a general curve in the plane of a line bundle has to be a linear combination of the canonical bundle and the O of 1. There are no other rational sections of the curve. So I'm reading this conjecture. And he said, well, you know, I don't know how to prove this, but it seems like it. Which is fine, right? Then, and this is one of these fascist era excesses of Italian geometry, Frontera came along and gave a completely bogus proof. Frontera, and it was a nice idea. He wanted to say, well, we can verify this, for example, for the locus of hyperelliptic curves. And then he said, well, if I have any curve, I can find any point in MG. I can find a surface on that in MG, which includes that point and meets the hyperelliptic locus in an ample curve. And then you can take the statement of the hyperelliptic locus and deform it out. And the problem is that's just flat out false. The hyperelliptic locus in MG has a very negative normal bundle, totally negative. So anytime you have a surface in MG, a two-parameter family of curves that includes a one-parameter family of hyperelliptic curves, that curve of hyperelliptic curves is going to have negative self-intersection. It will not prove. But Frankena made this argument, and it became Frankena's theorem briefly until the argument was debunked, in which case it did not revert to being the Enriquez conjecture, it became the Frankena conjecture. Anyway, I apologize. These are variously referred to as Frankena statements or Enriquez statements. I said they're largely unknown. Let me tell you what's known about these things, okay? First of all, oh my gosh, I should say it's a little odd. I did want to make one point that, as I said, this is something you can do in almost any setting. And something I'd like to come back to later, so let me just mention this very briefly. Another example of the same phenomenon is look at the Hilbert scheme of points of zero dimensional subschemes of P2. Okay? So what we have there, now this is, I mean, I gave you this whole rant about how awful the Hilbert schemes are, even Hilbert schemes of points. In the plane, the Hilbert scheme HD is in fact smooth and irreducible of dimension as you would expect, 2D. In this setup, there we have exactly the same sort of setup. We have a universal family of zero-dimensional subschemes of the plane, and we have an inclusion of that. I should write the whole thing. Say it maps to P2. And what would happen if we applied the same philosophy here? Well, this sigma over HD is just a branch cover. So what do I mean by the nomenclature tangent bundle? Well, you can just take the classes of the tangent bundle here divided by the pullback of the class of And what that amounts to is looking at the branch locus, which is just delta, the locus of the non-reduced curves. Okay, so that's one class that arises in this way. That would be the analog of the Kaplan class. The other thing you could do is, of course, again, you could take the class O of 1 and P2 and pull it back to sigma, and in this case, because the 5 dimension is 0, just push it forward on the same powers. What does that mean? It means exactly that we're looking at the locus of subschemes whose support meets a given line. So we have the divisor DL, which is the set of gamma, so the gamma intercept L is not empty. And we have delta, which is the locus of non-reduced gamma. And the conjecture would be that these generate the Picard. And in fact, they do. So these, though actually, interestingly enough, I should say they generate, take H, tensor Q. They don't generate over Z, because, and this is kind of interesting, the divisor class delta is divisible by 2 as a divisor class. Not as an effective divisor, as a divisor class. Okay, so this is something I might want to come back to, because there's a lot of interesting questions here. And this is one case where you can actually see the relationship between the divisor class theory and the new model theorem and different rational models in the same space. Okay, so these are the requisites for Pinner conjectures, and now let me tell you a little bit about this. So this is something clearly we're going to have to pursue next time. But let me just at least set the stage by talking about some of these questions. First of all, the Frankenberg conjecture, the conjecture is known for energy. This is true. And this was work originally of John Harrer. This proof was actually discovered at Columbia. The story is that Harrer was a topologist, right? And he had basically proved a theorem about the root cohomology of the mapping class group. Mumford had previously conjectured this statement for energy, that the Picard group was generated by the Kappa class. He happened to be visiting Columbia the same day as John Harrer was giving the talk. As a result, he went to the talk and immediately recognized that John Harrer had in fact proved his conjecture. So it was done. The problem is that Harrer's proof is a nightmare for a non-topologist. I can't speak for topologists, it may well be a nightmare for topologists as well. It's 100 pages, and I don't know anyone who has actually read the paper. So this is a situation that calls for some rectification. It was partially rectified by Arborello and Carvalho, who gave a more geometric proof, but still very much based on the topology of complex varieties and complex curves. So what we lack is, in some sense, an algebraic. And this is a challenge I'd like to propose. This is something that should be provable within the realm of varieties and schemes. It shouldn't need a complex, I mean, it's a perfectly unambiguous statement. And I've always been frustrated that it doesn't seem to have an algebraic geometric proof.
Is it known over an arbitrary algebraic proof?
You know, I don't think so. Oh, not characteristic zero.
I mean, Schroyer, Stefan Schroyer
lift it from positive characteristic.
Okay.
Characteristic zero.
So you deduce it from the positive characteristic from the characteristic zero. So now I think the potential readership of that has dwindled to a pretty small number. So you have to be a topologist to follow the original argument of characteristic zero, and then you have to be interested in characteristic p for all that a great job. Sorry, you were going to say?
So does Arbor and Cronulla, they also talk about MGM, right?
Yeah, that's right.
I was almost very confused. When I looked at it, so they really do not use the Harder frame, but they use another ingredient from topology?
Well, yeah. Okay. I don't know how to characterize their proof, but it is very, very much bound up in the topology of complex Riemann surfaces. Okay. What is also known is that the conjecture for H implies the conjecture for MG. Well, specifically, I'll leave out the subscripts. Do you remember what we had when we talked about the relationship between this Hilbert scheme and the moduli space in general? When D is large, where D is large relative to G and N, we can sort of take the map from H to the moduli space and factor it into a series of free Hilbert maps. We have over N, we have the space PDG. So this is the space of pairs, a curve and a line of 4 degree D. Over that, we have the space script GND, which is the space of triples, a curve, a line bundle, and an N plus 1 dimensional vector space of sections. And then, of course, we have H, which essentially amounts to choosing the basis of sections. So when D is bigger than is large, these are all very nice bundles, or at least if we're restricting ourselves to the smooth loci, they are open subsets of bundles. This is a PGLN plus 1 bundle. This is a Grassmannian bundle. And this is, of course, a principally polarized Abelian variety. And in each case, we can relate the Picard groups of the space upstairs to the space downstairs. If I have a PGLN and plus one bundle, I can say what the Picard group here is in terms of the Picard group here. Likewise, for a Grassmann bundle, certainly. And for the Abelian variety bundle, you also get given that the, let's say, Picard, we are out of time. The point is that if I know the conjecture here, I can deduce the conjecture here. And so this is what gives me hope that there may be an algebraic proof, some lurking somewhere, just waiting to be found. The idea is that when we are dealing with the Hilbert scheme, we have many more tools to try to get our hands on the geometry of space. And I will pursue this a little bit more. We'll talk more about this next time, but I think we'll stop here.